SMART Orchestra concert this afternoon. You can kind of notice from the way some of us have added a little, Valentine bling to the traditional concert outfit. Today's concert is Symphony from the Symphony Club. It's all about, since it's near Valentine's Day, it's all about music related to love stories. And the first one was Rossini's Barber, Seville Overture, which most of you probably, at least if you're of a certain age, my age, you probably learned from a Bugs Bunny cartoon, The Rabbit of Seville. Okay, I'll be honest, how many people imagine barber chairs racing up and down? Come on, yeah, me too. Rossini is an interesting character. He had the career that we all want. He was so successful at writing opera that he retired, he wrote the opera William Tell and retired at the age of 37. And he spent the rest of his life in Paris, basically holding a salon, an evening, kind of gathering, cocktail party for the artistic people of Paris. And he also liked to cook. If you know, there's a veal dish called Tornados Rossini, which allegedly he invented. But at these soirees, people would come and make music. And once a young soprano came and she sang an aria from the Barber of Seville, and she added so many of her own embellishments that Rossini at the end said to her, oh my dear, that was absolutely wonderful. Now, please, could you tell me, who's the composer of that? Very, very, very ready wit, Rossini. We're gonna move on and give you some selections from Andrew Lloyd Webber's spectacular hit musical, The Phantom of the Opera. Was doing a little research on this. It's been running since about 1988, and the worldwide gross receipts from it are about $6 billion. In the United States, they estimate the gross receipts are about $1 billion. Interesting that the Broadway run of Phantom just closed very recently in 2023. And some of the people in the pit orchestra for Phantom of the Opera have been playing the same musical for 35 years, over 10,000 performances. I don't think there's any kind of medal for that, but certainly the paychecks couldn't hurt. The legend is that some guys just bring a magazine, and because they play the parts so many times, it's pretty much memorized. But these should mention a little bit about the novel from which Phantom of the Opera comes, Gaston LaRue's novel of the same name. Doing my research, I didn't know it was written rather later than I thought, about 1910. And the first movie version, a silent German film from a German production company, came out in 1916, which has since been lost. Probably one of the most famous silent ones is Lon Chaney's Phantom of the Opera from 1925. Very, very famous. I was also interested that there are a couple other interesting versions of it. There's one called Phantom of the Mall. I have to admit that the title made me think, well, I don't really want to look further into that, but you feel free to do your own research on that. And the other one I actually read, a book called The Canary Trainer, in which the Phantom's opponent, in this case, is none other than Sherlock Holmes and his colleague, Dr. Watson. Our next selection, selections from Phantom of the Opera.
Thank you.
Shakespeare said, the course of true love doth not always run smooth. And in the world of opera, that tends to be the rule rather than the exception. We're going to do the next four selections, what's known as the first suite from Georges Bizet's opera, Carmen. Some of you, once again, of a certain age, remember the Bad News Bears. You may recognize a fairly good amount of this movie music. It's a tragic story, but it does have everything. It's got very passionate love between the two principals, a very innocent love. The tenor's childhood sweetheart comes back to try and talk him out of the bad choices he's going to make, becoming a smuggler. And she fails, unfortunately. It's got bullfighting, it's got smoking and cigarettes. Most of the female members of the chorus are cigarette factory workers. It's got, if we were advertising in the 50s or 60s, they'd say, something for the whole family. But Carmen is now one of the most famous operas in the world, but it didn't do Bizet a lot of good. Bizet had a hard time mounting the production. At its first performance, it was roundly criticized. He said his music was too much like Wagner. And when you listen to it, you say, well, it's nothing like Wagner. But remember, this is written 5 years after the Franco-Prussian War. So anything that sounds remotely German in Paris is probably not going to get a good reception. Even though Carmen is a tragic love story, there's also a ghost story involved. About 4 or 5 months into production, the first run of the opera, there's a scene in the third act where Carmen is telling fortunes with cards. And the cards keep coming up with death, like every card she turns over is a harbinger of death. The soprano singing in the first production one night came running off stage at the end of that scene and just about hysterical. And they asked her why, and she said, well, in the middle of that scene, I saw Bizet standing on stage with me. And Bizet had left for his home a little bit outside Paris a couple months before. Well, in the papers the next day, Bizet had died that night, approximately the time that the soprano saw him on stage. So, tragically for Bizet, the opera became known around the world. So we're going to play you five selections from Georges Bizet's Carmen.
Thank you. Pops concert from the Symphony with Love. This has been quite a year for us. Not only are we celebrating our 15th anniversary, but we were also just voted Best Classical Artist in the 2024 inaugural San Francisco. My name is Jeremy Zerstika, and I've been a musician with the SMART Orchestra since 2018. And in that time, your generosity has been instrumental in bringing the transcendent power of music to life. As we continue our mission to enrich lives through melodies, we rely on your benevolence to sustain our endeavors. Your donations, no matter the size, serve as the cornerstone of our orchestra's existence, allowing us to nurture local talent, stage remarkable performances, and foster a love for music that's accessible to all within our community. At the beginning of the season, we set a fundraising goal of $15,000. I'm proud to say that to date, we are already at $10,975. We still need your help. Music is very expensive. Let's see here. Please consider becoming a patron for the SMART Orchestra today. Like all these amazing people up here in businesses, the SMART Orchestra wouldn't exist without them or without you. You may become a patron by visiting www.smartorchestra.org/patrons or simply by using the back of your printed program. Next slide, please. All right. Dr. David Cole is one of three finalists from a pool of 18 candidates we interviewed this summer. By now, I'm sure you can all see why. How about another round of applause for Dr. Cole and his colleagues? This May, once our leadership team has made its decision, one of these three finalists will take the stage as SMART's official artistic director, and we want to invite you to celebrate this momentous occasion. Be sure to mark your calendars for May 18th, when we bring you our 15th anniversary gala concert called Director's Choice. Thanks, everyone, and now we'll get back to the show.
Thank you.
it's actually the prelude to a ballet, and it fits into our theme of love, where a Persian prince falls in love with a Péri, who is this very beautiful spirit. We might call her a genie or a djinn. Also, those terms seem to be somewhat interchangeable. In this case, she guards a flower of life. And while she's sleeping, the prince is so enamored with her beauty that he comes and he essentially steals her. He steals the flower of life. And as soon as he grabs it, she wakes up. And, you know, she knows that if he takes the flower of life, the Péris, all of them, will wither and die. And so she asks for it back, and he won't give it back. And so she starts to persuade him to give the flower back, and eventually she does, and peace is returned to the kingdom. One of the most interesting things about Paul Dukas, if we were a rock star, we'd call him a one-hit wonder, because everybody knows The Sorcerer's Apprentice. It's not too surprising, we only know a few pieces by him, because he was probably the most self-critical composer in history. Had a composing career of, maybe roughly 40 to 50 years. And out of those 40 to 50 years, only 18 of his pieces survive. They weren't lost in, lost in war or something else. He burned them, the other pieces, himself. That he was so adamant about maintaining the quality of his work. Just burned everything but these 18 pieces. But the other 18 pieces, for example, after this fanfare, there's an absolutely gorgeous 25-minute ballet after what you just heard. I'm going to move on to music from Titanic. Oh, wait, I'm doing that wrong, aren't I? I knew if I didn't use my notes, I'd get this wrong. Monolith Defies Ritual Fire Dance is another kind of really odd love triangle, in that a young widow, as after appropriate period of grieving, has found a new lover, and they want to eventually get married, but the ghost of her ex-husband keeps getting in the way. You know, happens to all of us. They hire a local witch to cast spells to drive away the ghost of the ex-husband, most of which don't work, and the final solution is that somehow the witch and persuades the ghost to go off with her, and the couple are left happy ever after. The ritual fire dance is one of the pieces, one of the spells that's used to try and charm away the ghost of the ex-husband. So, ritual fire dance, one will divide.
Thank you.
Eric's better with the microphone. From Manuel de Valle's El Amor, Brujo, moving on to music from Titanic. And the story is well known, as are the circumstances. I think two kind of interesting things are the people who didn't sail on the Titanic, people who booked passage and then, for one reason or another, just had to cancel. Three important people. One of the persons scheduled on the Titanic was the financier J.P. Morgan. And he decided at the last moment he had other pressing business that required him to stay on the continent. He didn't sail on it. Another industrialist, Henry Clay Frick, well-known, we know him mostly today, as a philanthropist, various art museums and concert halls and other things. One of the Vanderbilts, George W. Vanderbilt and his family, he actually said in correspondence that he didn't trust maiden voyages of any steamship. Seems like a smart move on, in retrospect, at least. Also, Robert Bacon, the U.S. ambassador to France, was scheduled on the Titanic. Other interesting thing, if you're a conspiracy theory fan, and here's one for you, or at least in terms of premonition. In 1898, there was a novel published by a gentleman named Morgan Robertson called The Wreck of the Titan. Written in 1882, 14 years before the sinking of the Titanic. And The Wreck of the Titan tells the story of an unsinkable ocean liner, which is how the Titanic was advertised originally. And this unsinkable ocean liner, the Titan, struck an iceberg and sank. And even more eerily, in the follow-up, the Titan was discovered not to have enough lifeboats, which is exactly what happened in the sinking of the Titanic. Up to that time, probably one of the greatest naval disasters in history. As you know, you've probably seen on television that there's been extensive research on the wreck of the Titanic. Some of the furniture, some of the dishes and glassware, is just left in its original place. Right? Kind of a strange and moving memorial to the people who sailed on the Titanic. So we'll continue with music from the movie Titanic.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, our next selection is from Richard Rodgers and Robert Hemp. Richard Rodgers' musical Carousel. And Carousel isn't really unusual as a Rodgers and Hammerstein musical, but it is an unusual musical. Just to summarize the plot a little bit, bad boy meets good girl. Bad boy gets suckered into a robbery attempt. Bad boy gets caught, kills himself, goes to heaven, comes back as an angel to make sure his daughter is okay, returns to heaven. It's a little more complicated than that, just in the short music. At the time it was written, which is 1945, a musical that discusses and portrays domestic violence and suicide is a really, really unusual thing. And Rodgers and Hammerstein's very sensitive handling of the subject and sympathetic handling of the subject is one of the things that makes this a great musical. The bad boy in question is a worker for a carnival. And in a dream sequence in the course of Carousel, the music imitates the sound of a merry-go-round, a carnival merry-go-round going on. And as many things in dreams, everything is not quite as it seems is in reality. And so as you hear the harmonies that begin this waltz from Carousel, this is all part of the dream sequence. So the waltz from Richard Rodgers' musical Carousel.
Thank you.
next selection is music from the 2005 film Pride and Prejudice. It's one of actually a number of different films and TV adaptations of Jane Austen's novel. And recently, within the last couple of years, picked up Jane Austen's novel to read it. How many have seen the movie of Pride and Prejudice? How many of you read the book? Not bad, not bad. That's really funny. One thing that struck me is that for a central character like Fitzwilliam Darcy, he doesn't appear in the book very much, which I found kind of astonishing. But he is certainly present when he's not present throughout the entire wonderfully told novel. There are so many different adaptations. We don't have time to list them all. I thought one of the strangest bits of fan fiction is a book by Seth Graham Smith called Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. maybe we'll save that for a Halloween concert perhaps. But the atmospheric music that Dario Marianelli wrote really reflects the wonderful bucolic nature of Regency England and the tender hearts of the characters involved in Pride and Prejudice.
Thank you.
final selection this afternoon. We're going to perform something that you might not at first think it's a love story. Raiders of the Lost Ark. There's some archaeology involved in it too, if I recall correctly. But the relationship between Indiana Jones and Marion Ravenwood is part and parcel of the story. And in the great tradition of Wagnerian opera, it takes another three movies for that relationship to finally resolve itself in Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. I'd like to before we do this final number on our program, thank you again for coming to this concert with the SMART Orchestra. We really appreciate your patronage. I'll put in a plug. If you've got an instrument that you play regularly and need a place to play it, I'd say get in touch with the leadership team here and join us. Because this is not just a wonderful orchestra, it's a wonderful community of people. And in the 5-6 weeks now that I've been able to associate with them and make music with them, they are a warm, friendly, caring bunch, and I think you will feel very, very welcome here. Yeah. Also, I'd like to thank the folks here at First Baptist for all of their help. Also, at First Lutheran for their graciously giving us the rehearsal venue, to Jeremy Sustaita and all the leadership team, and to the wonderful members of this orchestra who've given their time, dedication, hard work, and they've had to endure a lot of really bad conductor jokes. So hats off to them. We do have, before we start the last piece, Jeremy's waving frantically to me, so I know there's something. We have, I believe, a raffle.
Sorry, guys, I do not have the raffle. That will be after what I say right now. But my name is Marissa Chartier. I am the Associate Artistic Director with SMART Orchestra. So I handle all of our SMART Sessions recitals. And if you aren't familiar with what that means, SMART Sessions essentially is a small subgroup of SMART, and it's where we perform chamber music, solos, duets, trios, even a little bit more, or wherever the main orchestra cannot fit in a venue. So for example, we played at Wonderworld's 100th anniversary this year, which was very fun. Our next recital is titled In the Moonlight. It is a recital featuring very calm and serene music, kind of like the nighttime sky. It will be on March 16th at 4:30 p.m. and we are excited to be hosting at the San Marcos Public Library this time. This is our first time performing there. And I did want to plug our next thing. It's coming up in June, so it's quite some time, but it is our annual composer's recital. So if you are someone who composes, or you know someone who composes, be on the lookout on our social media. It's all at SMART Orchestra. And be on the lookout for the composer's submissions. Those will open up in March. Thank you so much. Now it's raffle time.
We have a winner.
Perfect.
Thank you.